Miller. Rise, medicine, seem blue again. What else could I do again? But keep repeating, true and true, I love you, love you. I still recall the thrill. I guess I always will. I hope we'll never depart. Here with your lips to mine, the rhapsody divine, sing with the strings of mine. Sing with the strings of mine. Sing with the strings of mine.
Thank you so much.
All right, let's see. So welcome everybody. My name is Garth Johnson and I'm the Paul Phillips and Sharon Sullivan Curator of Ceramics at the Everson Museum of Art in beautiful Syracuse, New York. So it's a glorious day today for many reasons. I am, I think for the third or fourth week in a row, actually back at the museum and talking to you surrounded by some beautiful objects from our collection. And I see a lovely range of humanity out there in the audience, and it includes some special guests. So today's topic is going to be kitsch, camp, pop, and all of the gray areas in between there. And my co-host for today, is the wonderful Ryan Wilson Kelly. So Ryan, say hi to everybody.
Hi to everybody.
So the format of the object study sessions has evolved a little bit from kind of a strict academic format when we started the series many, many weeks ago. I think this is like week 16 or week 17 of doing this virtual object study session. So it started as a class for Syracuse University. I was trapped at home. I had no access to the museum's collection except through photos in our database. So we turned to collectors, we turned to scholars. And several weeks ago, I turned to just kind of choosing a single co-host, someone that whose work that I really like or whose brain that I like or both, who would help me sort of drill into a single topic. And so I invited Ryan Wilson Kelly with no real preconception of what topic that we could choose, history being a potential one that is a strong suit of Ryan's. But I was really happy when right away Ryan chose the topic of Kitsch, which is a tangled and interesting topic and one that is close to my heart, but I have a conflicted relationship with, as I think many of you out there in the audience probably do. Ryan, I'll introduce you very quickly. You are a professor at Western Washington University in Bellingham?
Yes.
Okay. You hold your MFA from the Ohio State University and your undergrad degree from the Kansas City Art Institute. You're an alum and have close ties to the Clay Studio in Philadelphia, also close to my heart, Baltimore Clay Works. Ryan, can you tell me a little bit about why you chose the topic of Kitsch?
Well, I think, I have kind of a tenuous relationship with the ceramics world. I mean, I'm a ceramics professor and you highlighted my ceramics pedigree, but within the world of ceramics, I think my earliest love and the thing that keeps drawing me back are these kind of peripheral things, the things that are like the weird things that happen in the decorative arts, the weird things that happen in tchotchkes, I just find there's something about the material of ceramics that lends itself to these, a lot of different things, but I'm over caffeinated and over excited right now. I've always loved Staffordshire figurines and thrift store tchotchkes, kind of maybe above, Peter Volkis, for example.
So, this is going to be a great conversation because I love Kitsch. I love pop culture. And it's interesting that I turned 47 this year. The 90s were an interesting time to sort of, be a young man in terms of popular culture. And it's interesting, I'm now in my late 40s and feel like my connection to sort of what the kids are into sort of gets more and more tenuous each day. And I find myself moving away from some of my foundational sort of loves of campy, kitschy objects, or I find myself more and more conflicted, or I don't fill my domestic space with them in quite the same way. And so that'll be part of the discussion, I think, from my end. And it's also interesting to have found myself, I think, in the early 90s as, a lover of ABBA and the Spice Girls and sort of lots of different types of pop culture. And I saw what I did as sort of leveling a lot of those things and equating a lot of those things together. But now I find myself in sort of literally the most Tony museum collection for studio ceramics. And I find myself constantly grappling with the lens that the artists were using when they were creating the objects that are in the collection. But I'm someone who's always trying to find the fun and the life in the historical. And I think that you've always had interesting strategies in being attracted to the historical, but then finding ways to bring them to life. Papier-mâché, I think, being a huge one of those. Can you talk a little bit about, your use of fun and history within conversations about pop culture and kitsch?
Well, let me pull out my Susan Sontag here. I you know, was brushing up, and she did say something in her seminal essay, Notes on Camp, something about, okay, though I am speaking about a sensibility only, and about a sensibility that, among other things, converts the serious into the frivolous, these are grave matters. I think there's something about, like, you know, having like an intellectual gravitas, wanting to, like, having an urge to have a sense of intellectual prowess, but then feeling discomforted by that, or feeling that that is elitist or alienating. You know, I grew up in a house with, you know, my dad is a rare book collector, and my mom is a painter, and, you know, my family is very, you know, there's a lot of intellectual conversation, but there's also this kind of simultaneously love of, like, just idiotic humor, you know, scatological humor. And I've always been in that place where, like, you know, feeling the need to kind of undercut the things that I'm also, like, really engaged with, and becoming engaged with history or with like deeply researched topics as an artist trying to convey those things. I don't want my conveyance of them to be boring. I want to keep people on their feet and keep people interested through the way I present that. So I think any time that I'm demonstrating some sort of historical tidbit, I enjoy the kind of the campiness of how it might be presented, to take something big and deflate it a little bit.
Okay, so are you ready to nail Jell-O to a wall? I am someone who sort of hates to jump through linguistic hoops, and when someone asks the question, what is craft, or what is the difference between art and craft, I just start to...
I just hear like a shrieking, like an inner shrieking.
Yes, the chalkboard. But I think that we do have to probably lay out at least some of the squishy outlines about what kitsch is and what camp is. And as soon as we offer up those opinions, I think of our own, you already brought up Susan Sontag, we will bring on sort of our special guest host for this episode. Okay, so the thing that you brought up from Sontag, she points out that there is, to her, and we have to point out for anyone who hasn't read Notes on Camp, which I hadn't in about 20 years, and when I kind of reread and skimmed through it, I was kind of delighted that it truly was notes, and it's this frothy, scattershot essay, and it dates to 1964. And I think her putting a name on some of these things in 1964 is really amazing to me. You know, sort of as the Beatles are dominating pop culture, you know, while there are still in earnest, there were pop culture intellectuals sort of out there. But the thing that you brought up was the sort of seriousness of intent with the objects that are considered to be kitsch or camp. So can you help me sort of further define? Let's start off with kitsch, and what would be sort of the definition of a kitsch object, or things that would make an object kitsch?
Well, I think, I mean, we could take the linguistic route, which I think it is either German or Yiddish, meaning something like to cheapen or to make something cheap. And I think of kitsch primarily in a aesthetic sense, like a physical aesthetic sense. Although I suppose you could have, you know, kitsch sensibility in other ways, but I think of it in terms of material objects. Certainly, I think of our current president as an example of a kitsch maven, maybe a malignant one. but I think of it as facade, as glittering, you know, metallic plastic objects and squeaky toys. I'm being vague here because, I mean, like, the difference between Kitsch and Camp, I feel like is slippery, but I think for both of them, once you define them, you are, they're, like you said, it's like nailing Jell-O to a wall.
If we think back to, you know, some of the kind of origins of Kitsch being given a name and sort of being put into culture, you know, we're talking about the early 20th century. I think it existed sort of as a term that went back deeper than that and longer than that. But, you know, the design intelligentsia and the material culture intelligentsia, I would say in Germany and the Germanic countries in particular, were sort of obsessed with wiping away the cuckoo clockness, I think, of material culture and replacing it with something that had sort of more truth in materials and you know, was sort of designed more directly. One place that I would love to encourage people to go visit if you get a chance is a place called the Museum der Dinge in Berlin, the Museum of Things. And that is the museum that is attached to the German Werkbund, the sort of coalition of designers in Germany. And they went as far, they were so disturbed by the sort of prevalence of cuckoo clock and figurine culture in Germany in the early 20th century, that they actually got together and they created kits of well-designed objects that they would send out to schools. And at the Museum der Dinge, they actually have one of these beautiful crates that's filled with sort of glorious Bauhaus-y objects that went out to students to be able to teach them what was good design and what was bad design. So I think that, you know, this operation between high culture and low culture is a part of it. And then nostalgia, I think, is another huge part of Kitsch. Nostalgia and nationalism, I think, could be sort of put together. Do you have any observations on those two things?
Well, first I wanted to kind of insert into that Germanic relationship Adolf Loos and ornament and crime, just as an example of how the kind of the pendulum swing within that early Germanic, early 20th century Germanic relationship to decorative arts. But nostalgia, how about this? I was on a school trip to Germany in around the year 2000. And we went to Dessau, which was a Bauhaus kind of like Bauhaus factory town. And literally all of the Bauhaus like housing had been kitschified. They had like put faux Tudor wood paneling. They had put like cute little ceramic gnomes in the windows. And there was only one house that had been restored to the original Bauhausiness. And I feel like there was this, people like reverted to this kind of sentimentality or to this nostalgia for some sort of like Bavarian, non-existent Bavarian past, even in this like kind of modernist industrial town. But I don't know, in terms of, I feel like maybe you have something that was on the tip of your tongue, Garth, about nostalgia.
I think often there's this sense with Kitsch that, and I think one of the things that Susan Sontag sort of lays out for Camp, which, you know, goes double for Kitsch, is that often it is a copy or a simulacra of something. And so in copying the thing, you know, it's the cheap version of the thing, but often it's just a very surface longing for the original thing, and they're propagated in
yeah. A certain
way. I think reproductions of mid-century modern furniture are kind of amazing Kitsch that you can get at Target and other places, and is sort of the de facto thing that someone who wants to signify that they're living in a modern environment, you know, that's the sort of go-to. Not that my life isn't filled with some of those as well. So I think we could sort of go on and on down this rabbit hole, but this is a perfect time to think generationally as well, and to invite in our special guest host, Mr. Mark Burns, eminent artist, educator, and ex-resident of Las Vegas. And for many, many of us in the ceramics world, a mentor, I think, both where style and substance is involved. So Mark, do you want to unmute yourself and say hi? You're still on mute, Mark. He's getting there. Here we go. Oh,
is that better?
Yes. Hi, Mark.
Now, can you hear me?
I can, perfectly.
Okay. I'm trying to think of something pithy to say. Hey, Ryan.
Hey, Mark.
Hey, Andy. How's that Jell-O coming? Well, it's good to be here. This is near and dear to me. You didn't call me King Kitsch for nothing for all those years. Generally speaking, I fell into it without even knowing what I was doing. And so it's interesting that you're talking about Sontag and such. I was just a kid from the cornfield, and I liked to make monster models, and I couldn't figure out, when I got to grad school, what all the hubbub was about. I basically fell into it because I was basically appropriating my own culture. I'm not Japanese, I'm not Chinese, I'm not any of those things. And I worked with things that I had grown up around, and there wasn't much to see where I lived. And so I took a lot of humor. So you're looking at also television and cartoons, comic books, the monster model, boys, I'm an original monster kid, and sort of all of those things. And so I was really surprised when I found out, and you have to remember, a lot of this stuff was made before some of you were born. How it was really treated like it was trash. Nobody wanted to look at it. You weren't serious enough about your ceramics, what you were doing with it. And I couldn't see much of a difference between, let's say, a cheap pair of salt and pepper shakers from Niagara Falls, or mice and figurines. There's simply mile markers for people at a specific point in time. Intellectually, I could understand the need for the historical things and the sort of dissection of it. But emotionally, I just didn't want to make it. I just couldn't bring, I tried and I failed miserably. So I'm not exactly sure what to say about it. I think that for me, the serious part of it underneath it, which many people have escaped for 50 years, is I'm actually pretty serious. And those are ways to address a number of things, cultural issues, historical issues, pop culture, and not lose the thread that the worth of the object being made is that it has to be able to speak in any number of languages, people.
So if, you know, I think
that's all going to be on the exam. So I hope you took notes.
Absolutely. And so one of the very first things that you talked about was the, you know, sort of generational one, and the fact that in the early 1970s, you know, the 50s were not that far off. And, you know, you grew up in a time, and we had a really interesting discussion back in the 90s when I was in grad school, and the 50s are a visual touchstone for you. And, you know, oh, yes. You argued to the death that there was a primacy and a supremacy of 1950s design and its power. And we talked a little bit about, you know, you were like, the 90s are not a memorable era of visual culture. And I think I was pushing back on that and arguing with that. But it's interesting that now we've reached the era of nostalgia for the 90s among people who were not alive then. And hypercolor shirts and the Spice Girls and you know, certain other sort of day-glow visual things that were recycled from the 60s have now been sort of recycled into a type of nostalgia. But it's really interesting to think about those cycles that go on. But I want to introduce the idea of camp, and we haven't talked about sexuality at all in this discussion yet. And it's something that Susan Sontag is often, you know, sort of faulted for not bringing up until the very end of Notes on Camp. She sort of talks around gay culture, I think. And, you know, we're talking about 1964 when she wrote the thing. But Mark or Ryan, from your generational perspective, can you talk about, so I think one of the things that sets camp aside from kitsch is that there is a certain inside baseball coded nature to how the gay community adopts that iconography. And I think it's been offered that society was not creating genuine reflections of gay culture back in the 50s, 40s, 50s, 60s, sort of in any era. And so queer culture had to sort of make its own references by adopting those things and kind of putting them into a canon. Can you talk about what that looked like in the late 60s and early 70s, Mark?
That's all. I get asked that a lot, and I have been over these many years. I think there was certain, we had our own language. We had to invent spaces for ourselves to exist in. And part of the deal was understanding who was looking at your work. They might see, you know, it'd be like if there were triggers, if you will. I mean, I could glue a picture of Joan Crawford onto something, and most people would think that I really liked Joan Crawford. But someone gay might come along and go, oh, there's a sister over there. There were all sorts of hidden gay things. Much of that I used to talk to Howard Kotler about. He urged me at some point to not be as coded or as hidden as he was, because it took years for people to sort of separate out all the messages that he was sending. So I think as generations go by, it's really remarkable for me to see how free people are to do this. I mean, here's a good one for you. I never put an actual penis on anything for years and years. I looked for other things, wrenches, hypodermic needles, all sorts of things like that, simply because, you know, I didn't want to send anybody running away screaming. And so now, I mean, I can stick all the dicks I want on anything. I mean, there's a lot of dick art out there. And I kind of, in many ways, because I'm old and decrepit, I think it was more interesting in a way. So with freedom comes all sorts of things. The camp notions had a certain sort of, it was great. It was like, that secret language, the secret handshake, the things that we could do to identify to others. And sort of now it's sort of all kind of out there. It's, and even that's being appropriated in particular other ways. Let's talk to somebody way younger than me. Hey, Andy. I think you, just out of grad school, makes amazing stuff. Right here, over here in the raccoon. What do you think?
What do I think about what? What do you want from me, Mark?
Well, everything. You're my best friend ever. What's it like making the kind of work that you make now? Do you find people embrace it? They just laugh and walk away? What do you want them to do when they look at it? I chose to try to cram in as many hidden messages as I could, so that there was sort of something there for everyone, I think, and still, again, work within my own culture. So
yeah, I think something you said that actually resonated with me, and it's the reason the work is good sometimes, your work, not mine, but, you know, talking about how you accidentally did it, you know, and looking at the notes on camp, as much as I like to make fun of those notes, you know, if you do it and you try to do it, it's not as good. But if you do it on accident because you're a dipshit from the Midwest, I think you're better at doing it, right? But yeah, you know, you speak in some codes, and there's, you know, you use humor. And I think humor is a great way to not only invite people in. It is coded, so you got to be in on the joke, but also I think it invites more people, and you're able to communicate, and you can communicate really complicated ideas that, you know, you otherwise wouldn't be able to do. And sometimes it's, you know, not as tactful, but I think it's a really, I don't want to say it's a smart way because that sounds a little arrogant, but it's a fun way to navigate the art space while simultaneously pointing fun at people that are within that space. So that's kind of how I've embraced it. And like, I mean, like I was just telling you, it was like grad school almost broke me because I couldn't be validated by anybody because they all thought I was an idiot. So I was just like, no. And so then I have to break apart the jokes for people and explain to people how humor functions. And then it's not funny anymore. And they're like, oh, I'm not sure I understand. And it's like, what? I guess I'll write a 45-page thesis about how humor works, and then I can get a huge piece of paper. So that's what I think, Mark.
So Andy and Mark and Ryan, I'm going to invite you to chime in a little bit. So one of the joys of being here at the Everson is that we have such an incredible collection of objects from different eras. And I would say that the Everson definitely bears the mark of queer culture and queer ceramic culture. Our director from 1975 up until 1995 was the inimitable Ron Kukta, who went on to be the editor of American Ceramics magazine. But as such, I think that, you know, we definitely have a lot of objects and showed artists like Leopold Foulem and Richard Millet over the years. But I'm so pleased that we have a very early Mark Burns masterwork in our collection, and is just to the left of me, and that is Magician's Dinnerware. So this dates from 1974, and pardon me, I'm going to be sort of picking up my camera and moving my camera around here. So it's a set of three plates, and sorry that I'm just not going to subject them to sort of me picking them up right now. They're decorated in kind of a trompe l'oeil style, and I will say that there are little reflections of visual culture from sort of the world of the visual world of magic. You can see the puffy sleeves of the magician. And I believe that he actually sort of has an ace in the hole, right, Mark?
Originally, that was the dead man's hand.
Okay.
That was being held when Jesse James was killed. The mirror was just sort of, was a funhouse reference. The one thing that we ever asked me about is that every single one of those plates is based on a grid of some sort. If you look at it, there's the checkerboard, there's the grid of crackers, and then the barbecue grill. So there was a recurrent theme that ran through. Also, that object is meant to be seen all as one piece. They all fit together, sort of like you might see dishes in a display in a department store. And then, of course, they're decorated front and back with things. And it had glow-in-the-dark decals on it, all sorts of stuff. The cards are real. I'm not Richard Shaw. I wasn't going for that. I had started just to put in other materials, basically because the ideas I had about things, which is a thing I enjoy so much about Ryan's work, is it just won't do everything. And sometimes you've got to go and get the thing that makes it work. And that caused no end of trouble because I wasn't being able to be pigeonholed anywhere. You have to remember the time when this thing was made, you didn't see a whole lot of this if you stepped outside the West Coast. And I'm not ashamed to tell you that it was the last gasp of anything connected to pottery. There's some plates there.
Yeah, but, they are
hanging all over the wall that you couldn't do anything with. And pictures and little sculpt, you know, little, you know, greetings from Death Valley and that kind of stuff. And I thought, well, I'll turn to that because that will legitimize me. Does that make sense to you? I was being legitimate to the material, but inside I was kind of screaming all the time, because I wanted, I like to put things together. And so there's the monster boy, you know, you glue it together and, you know, if you're lucky, you get high while you're smelling it and stick all that stuff together. So that one's a particular one. And it was interesting that, you know, where that, how the Everson got it, don't you?
It came from a collector.
By Ludwig.
Yes.
Which was interesting because he wrote the definitive book on Maxfield Parrish. And I was, don't think about that for a minute. He went from the sublime to the ridiculous. But I had met Coy and he really liked the piece. And so it's nice that it ended up in the Everson. But I hope that makes sense to you. To legitimize yourself at that particular time was kind of important. You do this thing and your career will move forward. If you don't do this thing, you'll just be in a garage somewhere making God knows what. So I think that certainly times were quite different at the time, and not to mention the fact that they're painted. I just, oh my God, he's painting. Oh, forget, burn him. I mean, it's the ceramic thing, it was just a thing. So now when you're talking about paper mache or your felting or your crocheting or your gluing jelly beans all over something, those have arisen to be legitimate ways to express yourself. But at that time, the paint thing was forbidden. And I kept saying, well, where am I not supposed to do it? And when I worked all the years at the restoration studios, lots of Kitsch things passed through my hands that were painted. And I think, well, I've been proven right here. It doesn't matter. It's no longer lazy people glaze.
And I love that part of your bio, actually, Mark, and not everybody on this call might be aware that you spent quite a bit of time in Philadelphia, I believe, as a ceramic restorer. And so restoring Hummel figurines and the damned umbrella bottom, I think, was a particular plague for you, right?
Yeah, well, you know, Goose Girl, the most broken object in the universe, I can turn out the braids in about 20 seconds flat. And some days I just make fingers all day. Pick one. Is it this one? No. Is it that? And it was a great education, but I think probably maybe on a spiritual level, I thought I was on the right path all along. I responded back to the objects and the cultures that they had come out of. And I was always glad when I'd go in and I'd see a little statue, you know, one of those I love you this much things or because that spoke to another kind of culture, one I grew up in. And I'm here right now in Kentucky, across the river from Cincinnati. And this place is just chock-a-block of low-end figurines that were manufactured around here. And so in my own way, I grew up looking at these kind of things. I'm working with them right now because I have no studio and no clay and all that. So I'm simply rethinking things I find at the Goodwill and using all the techniques I used at the restoration studio. So it's pretty interesting. But I think the idea of being legitimate is really important, to legitimize yourself and to simply make the best things that you know how to make and to take responsibility.
I like the point that you made also about appropriating one's own culture. And I think in the era that we're talking about or where we're talking from right now, you know, in an era where cultural appropriation is a really sort of hot button issue, I hadn't ever really quite thought of things like that. So I wanted to show a few slides that I brought up, and Ryan, you had brought up the president earlier, and I had actually thought of a movie that dates back almost 20 years now, but was very, very prophetic, and that was Mike Judge's Idiocracy. And some of us have rewatched it, I think, you know, since the pandemic, but so much of this, I think, is going to ring true. If you haven't seen Idiocracy, I recommend it. And this is a scene where this is the President of the United States, played by Terry Crews, and he is acknowledging a character by Luke Wilson, who was chosen to be the most average late 20th century resident, and he was frozen in time and unfrozen 100 years ago or 100 years later, and He ranks as a serious genius 100 years later because of the way that society has been going. So look at this dystopian vision of what government and our president was supposed to be like in 100 years. And I think it almost nails sort of our current moment. I think this is like the State of the Union.
I know she's down with all that starving bullshit and the dust storm. We running out of french fries and burrito covers.
Yeah.
But I got a solution.
That's what you said last time, dipshit.
I got a solution. You're a dick.
South Carolina, what's up?
That's what I thought. Now, I understand everyone shit's emotional, right? But listen up. I got a three-point plan to fix everything. Number one, we got this guy not sure. Number two, he's got a higher IQ than any man alive. And number three, he's gonna fix everything.
So I will just stop it there. We could go on and on, but I think that there were lots of elements of visual culture 20 years ago that Mike Judge really nailed. One of my favorites is that all of the police cars are covered in logos that are sort of derived from energy drinks back in the 90s. And I would say that energy drink design has driven itself deeper into our culture in that time period. Wanted to bring up just a few elements of sort of popular culture right now that are fun and frivolous and glittery, and I think often associated with maybe millennial culture. And I'm not the right person to be maybe chiming in, but this is the unicorn frappuccino, which sort of has glittery rainbow sugar. And I think sort of took the internets by storm a couple of years ago, and everyone was creating something that was unicorn. So is this kitsch? Is it camp? Is it just pop culture? Anyone who wants to chime in? Ryan?
It's expensive.
I wouldn't put that in my body. I might use it as a campy like accessory. So in that sense, I don't know. I feel like camp can be intentional, whereas kitsch needs to be unintentional.
I think this is camp that has been made into kitsch, maybe through sort of a recycling and recycling. I often try to sort of imagine what the designer is like sort of behind something. There's some poor food engineer who was just tortured within an inch of their life to sort of bring this into existence, I think.
I think that was made by an algorithm, Garth. I think the singularity is like...
So
I would agree with that. It depends on whose money they're after.
Yes.
Disney princesses or like LOQs. LOQ stands for two things, Lady of Quality or Loud Old Queen. And so this might be, I'm going to go down to Starbucks and get me a unicorn. I'm sorry. Get gay money. I mean, that's all I'm trying to say here. But I would, you know, I might wear it, but I wouldn't drink it.
So I mentioned earlier on that I am having a bit of a, my relationship with kitsch, I think, is a tangled one. And I don't sort of exclusively clothe myself in and adorn myself in kitsch these days, even though, you know, it's a lovely treat to when I do. But I started thinking about where kitsch intrudes in my daily life and if it's even possible to make kitsch today. And I think if you look at the realm of children's toys, and I have a 6-year-old daughter and a 9-year-old daughter, and my house is just full of Kitsch things that, you know, that they love. And we tried to raise our children with mostly wooden toys and some Fisher-Price toys from our childhood. But there became this tipping point with which I just realized that we just swam in these. So these are Shopkins, and any of you who are unacquainted with Shopkins, they are sort of the face of the devil, all of these little anthropomorphic, cute, kawaii, Japanese-influenced figures. And they hurt like hell when you step on them, I can tell you, from so many of them like being scattered around our house. And I would say that, you know, Hello Kitty and Japanese kawaii culture is something that definitely has sort of infected larger culture. And the third generation sort of copies of 50s atomic era Astro Boy culture, I think, pervade. The Japanese have definitely gotten their revenge on us in the United States. I wanted to point out this. This is an actual object that I think both of my kids own. So I think we live in a moment right now where the sort of purveyors of Kitsch, like, this is the algorithm. It has to have rainbow, it has to have glitter, it has to have unicorn, and it has to have poop. And so this is the Poopsie Glitter Unicorn, and it is a glittery poop emoji that you have to sort of open up, and it's like the pod from Invasion of the Body Snatchers or a 50s horror movie. Inside it is filled with glitter slime, and then there's a container in there that contains, you know, this unicorn with its long hair that sort of comes out of the slime like it was Luke Skywalker being healed in The Empire Strikes Back after he sort of froze inside of the Tauntaun. And then I wanted to bring up where drag culture has sort of gone. And I'm interested in the fact that drag culture has sort of gone beyond the unicorn Frappuccino and now is interested in sort of sci-fi and I don't know, body modification and androgyny in kind of a completely different way. And I didn't know if anyone wanted to chime in on any of these objects that, or ideas that I'm bringing up.
Everyone just, I don't know that I'm really qualified to speak on behalf of drag culture. I feel like it seems like with the explosion of Drag Race and the popularization, the platform that is given drag culture, the mainstreaming of drag culture, it has meant like a multiplicity, like a flowering of subgenres within that, just like any other mass cultural movement, like new niches will come out of it. Like, I'm interested in like the garbage drag where people are using like found objects and like literal garbage bags to fashion something out of, I don't know.
It's amazing, I think, that, you know, when you think that there is no way for the next generation to kind of move the ball forward, I think it's great to see where there are spaces for people to sort of do that. And I think build upon what has come before in interesting ways. So we're gonna turn, Ryan, to talking more about your work. And I had sent you a catalog of the Eversons collection. And one of the things that you zeroed in on the Eversons collection was figurative sculpture, ceramic sculpture from the 1930s and 40s, which on its face, I would think, reads as Kitsch, because you will find unicorns, you will find, this is actually a word that was applied at the time, cutesy figurative animals. And there were people who were pushing back within that in the ceramic world. This is the work of Vali Wieseltier, the Austrian designer. She was actually a part of the Wiener Werkstatt in Vienna, and made, it was really the part of the first generation of ceramic sculptors to make ceramic sculptures that were sculptures and not models for bronzes and other things. They were unashamedly ceramic. And look at the amazing way that, you know, you can see the fingerprints in it, almost like a piece of funk art. You can see that she's embracing the drippiness of the glaze and enhancing the sort of ceramicness of it. This is a piece called Taming the Unicorn, and it dates from 1941. But this piece was sort of revolutionary at the time. And I think one of the things that makes it not kitsch was sort of the original intent. And I think things can be cute, but not necessarily kitsch. I wanted to show everyone a piece that I wish was in the Iverson collection. And this is Vali Wieseltier. This is an orangutan. And Ryan and I were looking this over earlier. And this is sort of the unholy union of David Gilhooly and Betty Woodman, I think. Incredible, almost.
Viola Frey, too.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say a little Viola Frey, or I don't know. Dr. Zay.
Just a little.
But this dates, you know, from the 1940s, and it's amazing. And look at the, I don't know, sort of bad whiteware beige clay that she's using. And I adore this object so much. Viola is a really interesting touchstone because she was really interested in tchotchkes and kitsch objects and made work for a time that I think beautifully and lovingly kind of elevated those while still keeping them very fun in her work. And I thought that that would be, we don't have any in our collection, sadly, at the Iverson. Cookie jars are actually a huge part of the Iverson's collection, and we have a great collection of McCoy cookie jars in particular. And I will unpin my screen here, and I'm going to show off the pièce de résistance of our cookie jar collection. And Mark, I hope you're sort of enjoying this. I think this is also a McCoy piece. Yep. And I've actually deaccessioned quite a few cookie jars and mass-produced ceramic objects from our collection, but I refuse to let this cookie jar go. It lives in the offices, and throughout the pandemic, various people have been coming back from quarantine to find the clown on their desk. All right, so one of the beautiful pieces that I am hell-bent on keeping in the Iverson's collection. Let me share again just for a moment. And the have a happy day will be staying in the collection as well. All right, so Mark, I'm gonna put you on the spot right now. So we have pottery cookie jars from Laura Andreessen, Arthur Baggs, and other touchstones of sort of mid-century pottery, because the cookie jar was actually, for a time, I think, a trademarked functional object that a potter could make that was a large pot that was still functional, that could be kind of largely ornamental. So this is a functional piece dating from 1950 in our collection. Mark, would you like to take a stab at guessing who this artist is?
Wasn't me.
It was not Mark Burns, I can tell you that. Me. And by the way, anyone who wants to chime in using the chat feature, you know, please.
Vivica Hino.
Vivica Hino, I think that is a pretty good guess.
Mark, I guessed that it was Victor Schreckengast, but not.
So it is not Victor.
Thanks for mentioning Victor. He's happy about that. Viola Frey.
So this is Peter Volkos. Dates to 1950, and I think all of us can be heartened to know that Volkos could make a damn fine mid-century porcupine on one of his pieces. And a sort of, I don't know, huge. So it's a gorgeous piece of pottery. And one of the great things about museums is that they can really house the unexpected. All right, so I'm gonna shift gears and we're gonna start talking about your work, Ryan, sort of using some of the things that we've talked about up until now. And can you talk a little bit about your trajectory? And you know, we haven't exactly talked about you and your age and sort of your attraction to Kitsch and sort of coming to terms with your identity and sexuality and all of that stuff. And can you address kind of, I don't know, your undergraduate and your journey toward, I guess, sort of identity and art being wrapped together?
My God.
easy question.
That was a lot. Well, okay, so I went to undergrad at the Kansas City Art Institute, and at the time that I was there, there was kind of this segregation between hand builders and wheel throwers. And, you know, so we had these two cliques, these two little like kind of warring factions, not really warring, but I think the people who liked to read books and had a snarkier sense of humor were hand builders. And so I gravitated towards that group and, you know, was enthralled at the feet of people like Mark Burns. I remember when Enseca was at Kansas City and I went to an opening and I stood on the corner of a wall and was so afraid to go up to Mark Burns because, you know, he had this amazing piece that did have dicks on it, I believe, Mark. It was like Popeye. Oh, yeah. Do you remember that piece?
Which one? There are so many.
It was either like Popeye on one side and like...
Hey Sailor.
Yeah.
That's the title of that piece. Subtitled Sailors in Love. Popeye in Love, I think it is. Yes, it does stand. I had to look through many adult stores until I found just the right dildo to make a mold of, because it's kind of classical Greek. It's got a ball sack, and I didn't want it to be too big. And, you know, it's in Sex Pots, in case you're interested, though.
It's an excellent piece, and it holds a special place in my heart.
Bless you. I appreciate that so much. It's nice not to be forgotten. Hi, Kathy.
It's Kathy. Kathy King?
Yes, Miss King. We are being blessed.
Indeed.
But Garth, to kind of go back to your question, so I was, you know, a good Midwestern boy who'd grown up with an awareness of larger art movements, but not really of an awareness of ceramic artwork. And so my connection to ceramics was in the form of tchotchkes of, you know, like, you know, Royal Dalton figurines of like the balloon lady. Going to school in Kansas City, I was surrounded by all these like scrappy art kids, you know, talking a lot. And we were right next to two major museums, the Kemper Contemporary Museum and the Nelson Atkins. And, you know, on one day I could be seeing like a Michael Lucero installation. Another day I would be spent, you know, in the collection of the Nelson Atkins looking at like Bow China. Like there's a very specific Bow China, the Vain Jackdaw, which is like this sassy little, I think it's like an Aesop's fable, but it's like this bird that that takes plumage from other birds to make itself campier. And I just remember being in that space and like these hillbillies from Missouri being like, look at that. And I don't know, just feeling like it was like this high and low at the same time, like this weird little decorative object that was about ostentation, but it was itself kind of ostentatious, kind of meta moment. So I kind of was trying to absorb that and spit that back out into the work that I was making. But do you want me to address the image of mine that you had up?
Yeah, let's go ahead and bring that back up. And so, you know, in my thinking, you found a wonderful sensei in finding your way to Ohio State University and Mary Jo Bull, someone who has similar proclivities into bringing history and research to life. So let me get my screen up there again. And this is work that you made at Ohio State. And is this your actual thesis show?
Actually, I made this just before my thesis show. Okay. I think much to MJ's dismay, I made like a whole nother body of work right after this. but she's someone, as Mark was kind of talking about, who pushed me to think that, you know, if ceramics can't do everything well, that you should use it for the things that it really can sing at, that it is really meant to do, or that you can see it doing. But to cram everything into that one medium is kind of counterproductive at some points. And so in this grouping of work, I was thinking about commemoration and, you know, relating that to commemorative ceramic objects, the idea of memory and celebration, and celebrating high and low. So in this case, like, I'm celebrating these kind of, this weird story that brought together these people that have elevated statuses in different realms, but brought together in this kind of low rent instance. So it's I'm celebrating an event where Lou Reed of the Velvet Underground was out clubbing with Madeleine Albright, the first female Secretary of State, and Václav Havel, the then sitting president of the Czech Republic, leader of the Velvet Revolution in the Czech Republic. And they were out at a John Zorn concert, and supposedly John Zorn stopped the concert because they were making so much noise, and yelled at Madeleine Albright and Lou Reed and Václav Havel to, quote, shut the fuck up. I think Laurie Anderson was there too. So, just reading that weird little event, it was like, this is something that needs to be commemorated. This is so inconsequential, but like monumentally like strange in my world. So this was a graduate school attempt at trying to commemorate or monumentalize. Elsewhere in this exhibition, there were like these 3 foot tall ceramic busts of them, and then there were paper mache heads that you could put on. But this was the tchotchke kiosk, so there were ceramic busts, like slip cast busts, souvenir hankies, and these kind of dangling paper, like Halloween decorations of each of them.
One of the most valuable things that Mark Burns, I think, ever taught me was a personal philosophy about being able to not second guess yourself in terms of a crazy idea that you might have. And Mark, it's the whim of iron, I think, was the way that I always remembered it. So the opposite of the will of iron and being able to sort of plan everything. But the whim of iron is spending an inordinate amount of time taking an idea or something that makes you giggle and making that into a tangible reality. Is that something that resonates to this day,
Ryan? Oh, sure. Oh, of course it does. I mean, I spent a lot of time, and I think Ryan does as well, that these things are actually really multi-layered. And for me, there was always an entertainment factor. You could come to it and be entertained, like you watch a cartoon, but there are always other things. Somebody once described my work as being like an onion, and you could peel back layers, or music references, movie references. I rely heavily on scripture, for a lot of the things that I'm doing, and then try to, well, here's a good example. This is what I'm doing right now. Don't laugh. See this?
Let's see, hold on, let me stop. Go ahead.
See this? Got this? This costs 50 cents at the Goodwill. And it was a knickknack that had a god-awful decoration. And I learned how to take the decoration off of things at the restoration studio. And so what I'm doing is, this is these will be available at a Kmart near you soon. But what I've done, I've turned it into a figure, which is pushing a souvenir cup from the Wood of the Deads. And I'm sorry, the Wood of the Suicides. And, you know.
From Japan?
Oh, no. This is from Dante, because I'm a literary. So putting this thing together is, I've been cutting them apart and putting my own spin on them. And then, of course, part of the thing is the architecture of how they go together, because, you know, they're wood, they're plastic, and they're all going to be painted because I don't have any way. But it's really remarkable that these things are out there, and if they are stripped of part of their personality, they turn into something else. It's amazing how often they look like classical objects. So I'm looking back at them, and it's like, well, these are like Greek statuaries. We think they were white, but they actually were not. So reskinning, taking off things that I don't think belong there, and just using them to whatever jumps into my tiny mind. So these are interesting things, I think. I lost my train of thought. I'm just babbling, so.
No worries. It's
time for my nap.
I am about to show the Ben Franklin video that you did, or we're going to watch a little chunk of it.
Hey.
Ceramics doing the thing that ceramics does well, but you deal in video and performance and paper mache and puppetry. Can you talk a little bit about the genesis and the whim of iron idea that that started out, that bloomed into the Wizard Franklin video?
Let's see. So a quick background, like, you know, at the same time that I'm doing all of the, like going to school for ceramics, I also on the summers would work at the Detroit Institute of Arts in the education department. And it was there during the year that they hosted, or they put on a show of their puppet collection. They have one of the best puppet collections in North America. And I got to make a lot of the didactic puppets that people could actually use. And that kind of spurred this interest in getting to look at, you know, all these like physical objects, see how they were made, and then try and replicate them. And I've since, like, when I got to Philly, I worked at Spiral Q Puppet Theater and the defunct Mum Puppet Theater. So I've had this kind of parallel track of like making, you know, props and costumes and objects that are interactive. And that has bled over into other work that, you know, my artwork. And for the video that I think you're about to show, I was invited to be in a show at George Washington College, which is on the eastern shore of Maryland, and it was called Philadelphia Now. So it was you know, contemporary, like hot young Philadelphians making artwork. And I think there was the idea that we should be pushing the envelope, and it being George Washington University, or George Washington College, different from George Washington University, I was asked to kind of poke fun at, or kind of skewer or pop the balloon of George Washington, as like take him off his pedestal a little bit. So, kind of dove into history and based it a little bit on a correspondence that John Adams had, but maybe you should just show it.
And, all right, roll tape. Let's see. And a shout out to Dayton, Ohio's The Breeders here. Okay, so I'm going to cut it off there, but if you would like to view this video in its entirety, you can find it on Ryan's YouTube channel, and you can find that through your website, which is ryanwilsonkelly.com?
Yep.
Okay. Any final reflections on that piece? One thing that I wanted to bring up again was we were talking a little bit, and I think one of the things that you're obsessed with is the idea of myth making, and you know, certainly that's something that continues to happen with politicians and leaders in the United States, particularly in the era of social media. Are there any things that you wanted to reflect on in that regard to tie into Kitsch?
I'm not sure I understand your question. Like, what? I mean, so, the monuments are coming down, and I couldn't be happier if that's what you mean.
Yeah. So I mean, the monuments are one sort of manifestation, I think, of this idea of myth making, and you are, I don't know, again, sort of poking fun at the old white dudes who, you know, the patriarchy who built the country. Through the use of the papier-mâché and other elements. And do you see that as one sort of river that leads back to Kitsch?
The kind of visual vocabulary that I use, like these papier-mâché heads that are oversized, have like a visual, you know, cue. Pretty obvious, I would think, that they are kind of almost like bobbleheads. Like, they are themselves, like whenever I'm depicting them, they become like this kind of physical Kitsch object, or at least Kitsch inspired object. So I'm trying to like show like a literally inflated sense of importance by, you know, this like physical inflation of the head. And I'm not really sure I'm like answering your question.
Yeah, I don't know that there was a sort of direct question there, but I think, you know, it all comes back to the ideas of nostalgia for this idealized thing that, you know, never really happened. We've actually got some interesting Wedgwood Jasperware, American Revolution Wedgwood Jasperware, George Washington in our collection, which it's interesting, made by, you know, a British company, as long as they could market it for the export ware market in the United States. Money, I think, is often the thing that actually gets the thing made. It was perhaps Staffordshire's or Wedgwood's algorithm at the time. Let's go ahead and go to some more images. And you know, you've waxed and waned throughout your career. And when you sent me a PowerPoint that you had, and at some point in the PowerPoint was a return to the Kitsch object, which was where I wanted to go right now. So the objects that you make are so beautiful. And I want to point out for those of you who have not experienced one of Ryan's objects in person that, you know, he takes great care to inlay the slip lines. And you've revolutionized your process a little bit, I think, recently to make them sort of even more desirable as objects. But you have a certain power, I think, to your making. But you seem to wax and wane in terms of doing more ephemeral work and exhibitions, and then you return to the objects. And so let's look at some of those objects, and I'd love you to give us a little guided tour through some of them. And so we're going to start out here. So with these two objects from this series.
Do you want me to jump in?
Yeah, please tell us what we're looking at.
All right, so these are fairly recent. These are from my COVID quarantine series. Mm. And I think my swing back and forth between making performative video or, you know, installation-based work is, it's partly a product of the fact I live in a pretty small town without much of an art scene right now. And so my connection to opportunities to go do that kind of stuff is changed since moving here. And, you know, making small ceramic objects allows me to, you know, continue to like send these things out into the world. And it also gave me an opportunity to come back to these things that I love and to explore and like kind of delve into the narratives that might be there that I've always, you know, loved. And so these are kind of coming out of, you know, like Royal Dalton or different character jugs. Ultimately, they come from like the Toby jug, which is like the penultimate character that I, like I had a show a couple years ago called Toby Town that was inspired by, you know, the Toby jug. Got really into the history of the Toby jug, or Tobias Philpot, as like the original poem outlining who Toby was. And he had a female counterpart who was the personification of gin. So like Queen Juniper or Ginny. I think there's different names, but like these two kind of like haggard British figures that represent kind of overindulgent drinking and drinking culture, but also like this kind of kitsch object that isn't really all that functional. I don't know how drunk you could get using one of those things. So they represent this kind of weird, like kind of aesthetic object that is celebrating something that is kind of dark and weird, like this drunken culture, but it's also kind of smirking at itself. So a lot of these are, you know, in my childhood, these are things that if they were on a small scale, if they're Royal Dalton, they would be in a little curio cabinet. And I remember my grandmother had like several tiny little, you know, character mugs on her mantelpiece that, you know, they were these prized objects that small children shouldn't touch. And so they had this reverence for me. And so I think in some way I'm coming back to like my, you know, as a tiny little Midwestern boy being like, I want to hold Martha Washington and like drink juice out of her head. So the image on the left was supposed to be Martha Washington. I don't know why I didn't pair her with George in this grouping, but I think she turned out better than George Washington.
I've been sneaking some images in from the Eversons collection and tying things together as much as I can. And, you know, we do have this incredible Staffordshire. So we have two different sort of fishmonger pieces in our collection. We have a bow figurine of a lovely young maid selling fishes. And then we have this older oyster cellar in our collection. And you can see that she's got the oyster in her hand and the barrel has the actual pouring spout built into it. But I love this piece that you did of the fishmonger and the fact that you've got this flounder, which is an actual sort of 2D fish rendered as 2D there, I think is terrific. And then this presumably would be the source inspiration. Is there a brand or a factory that this?
I think that's Royal Dalton. And my grandmother had one of those that I believe was Royal Dalton, and it was under a, you know, one of those oblong glass domes that, you know, kept the dust away because it would be hard to dust all those balloons.
So I wanted to, let's see if I can, I wanted to put in a plug for a book that I absolutely love. And, you know, I see a lot of like-minded people on the call here, and I can't recommend this book enough. And it is called Ceramics, Ethics, and Scandal by Rosalie Wise Sharp. And I think it might be out of print and might set you back some money if you go questing for it, but this might be my favorite ceramic book ever. And it's taking the types of figurines that Ryan is using as source material, and it's kind of giving you the weird backstory of the pieces. For example, a lot of pieces that you see with Harlequins or Shakespearean scenes on them are meant to be certain actors. And so they're really the equivalent of, I don't know, a Spice Girl figurine of the time period, because they are right out of popular culture. The book also goes into sort of the shopping culture and the collecting culture of the people who sort of bought these figurines. There's a section on sporting figurines and boxing figurines. Definitely things about drinking and drinking culture. So if you are interested in digging into the sort of seedy underbelly of quote unquote kitschy figurines, you can't do much better than this amazing book. So Ceramics, Ethics, and Scandal by Rosalie Wise Sharp. Anyone who wants to come look at a copy can come to the Everson. We open to the public on August 2nd. We've actually got food trucks outside today in our plaza for the first time since the pandemic. All right, so let's jump back into Ryan, your some images of yours. And there is sort of a happy medium here, and a lot of cases where you are putting together larger installations that incorporate objects that you've made. And can you talk about your material culture references in this particular installation piece?
Well, the title of this piece is Bastard Bloomsbury. So for anyone who's, you know, an effete, you know, Anglophile, in my family, there was a particular interest with the Bloomsbury group. My parents would, you know, obviously someone like Virginia Woolf, you know, her intellectual concerns were talked about, but there was also this fascination between my mom and my grandma and her sisters about Vanessa Bell and the house that Vanessa Bell lived in with her sometime lover, Duncan Grant. And it was just like this kind of rambling country house called Chatham or something like that. But it's just filled with decorative arts that they, like things that they painted themselves. Like, and a lot of times it's falling apart because it was done with like crappy tempera paint or something. And it's also contains things from like early, like, you know, early 20th century, like not the Vorticists, but there was like the Omega group.
Omega Workshop.
Yeah, Omega Workshop. So I don't know, there's something about that kind of weird, kind of sloppy embrace of the decorative arts that I've always, it's always been kind of in the background of my aesthetic upbringing. And I figured that the only way I could insert some of these ceramic things into an installation was to kind of embody that reference and make my own kind of bastard Bloomsbury, you know, household. So I made all of those tiles for like the surround of the fireplace. There's faux Staffordshire spaniels. They're flat spaniels. and, you know, lots of kind of figurines around, you know, ceramic lamp, painted canvas backdrop and a painted floor mat. Yeah. And I think it's just supposed to represent like kind of the manic kind of horror vacui of like a queer person obsessed with the decorative arts in the 1920s. That doesn't really mean any, I don't know.
So let's take that sort of illogical sort of combination of things or conflation of things a little bit further. And can you talk about the hot dog series?
Okay, well. Well, speaking of coded language, so, you know, a lot of times I'll vacillate between making stuff that has self-portraiture and, you know, or things that are like deeply researched. But when I'm like kind of in a fallow spell, I will do something that is self-portrait based because I'm always here and I can always focus on myself. And for this, there's a grouping of work where I have portrayed myself as a hot dog. And I'm always it's called the hapless hot dog series, because I'm always kind of like freaked the fuck out. And this grouping was for a show that Mark actually invited me to. I had to remake it several times because I kept rushing it and blowing it up, which I'm, you know, ashamed to admit. Ceramics is a fickle medium. But in this case, it's myself as a hot dog and a hungry ape-like creature kind of leering at me. And then I think the next image relates back to that book that you're showing.
So can you tell us, for those of us who don't know, what the Death of Monroe figurine is? Can you quickly tell the Death of Monroe story?
Quickly, it's my favorite object in the world. There is a three-dimensional, at the Victoria and Albert, there's a large scale, like life-size wooden version that's actually a musical instrument.
Automata.
And it makes like a growling, gurgling sound, like it's ripping out the head of this British soldier. I wanna say it's to commemorate an actual event, but you know, I've read so many conflicting things that I don't know what to believe anymore. But the ceramic forms, I think, are kind of like commemorative objects or tchotchkes to kind of celebrate that. And so mine is like a riff on a riff of that original story, whatever it might have been. And in my case, I am being, you know, kind of humped and suckled and eaten by a tiger, but I'm a hot dog. I don't think you need to read too much into it. It's right there.
So I want to jump ahead to some of the last images that were in that presentation that you sent. And I really love these sort of Punch and Judy puppet images where you're performing with paper mache heads made into sort of gigantic puppets. Can you tell us about this exhibition as sort of a way to kind of draw our conversation to a close?
Yeah, sure. Well, like I said, I do pieces that sometimes will find their inspiration in like a deeper amount of research and exploration of a topic. And when I'm not really focused on something like that, I will kind of circle back around to self-portraiture. And in this installation, this was initially at Penn State Abington and last September. So I was I was excited to be able to show something larger to fill up space. And I had to ship things across the country. And so shipping lightweight things seemed a lot easier. So these larger paper mache pieces were easier to ship than a lot of heavy ceramic things. So there's a practical consideration. And the idea behind this piece was to, you know, kind of represent myself as a sock puppet who is, you know, in the Punch and Judy puppet series, there's usually like this infant or baby that just gets like tossed around or ignored or eaten by an alligator. And it usually has this dumb expression on its face that's like neither happy or sad, but it's like kind of like, is it angry? Is it excited? And that, depending on how you use that puppet, you can kind of exploit that frozen expression. So I've kind of imposed that on this self-portrait at, where I'm like the big baby. And then the Punch and Judy alligator is, or crocodile is there with his tantalizing sausages.
and then we have also
in that exhibition, there are these fists on poles holding kind of phallic food objects. So described it as a fisted forest of phallic foods. I like, you know, wordplay. and I mean, honestly, this is just like allowing myself to kind of be incongruous and to kind of throw things together. The image on the, or to the left of the image is a kind of anthropomorphic clothes drying rack. And I remember seeing these as a child and always thinking that they looked, you know, frontally, they kind of look like a figure. And so I made this thing, this kind of like big object. And obviously what do you hang out to dry but jock straps and tube socks? And that's what's hanging from that. So it's all like kind of coded, lightly coded kind of sexual imagery. Maybe it's not even coded. It's just there.
Single entendre.
One entendre.
All right. So I think that is just about where we need to bring our conversation to a close, but I'm going to invite everybody to stay for the after party. It's always great to have people unmute themselves and say hi. Kathy King, Janice, other people who are on the call that we know and love. It would be great to see your sweet faces and talk to you afterwards. So Ryan, I know that like every artist under the sun, you've been affected by COVID-19 and you had shows canceled. Can you tell us what you're working on right now and what you're looking forward to once the COVID pandemic has died back?
My studio is kind of crowded with all these small ceramic pieces that were supposed to go to a show. Who knows if they'll ever. And I am kind of quickly shifting gears to work on a piece I'd kind of forgotten. I've been invited to a show at Northern Clay Center centered around the election. And I'm trying to repurpose a couple pieces and create something new to ship out to them in August. And that show hopefully will be live. People will be able to physically attend it. And other than that, I am, you know, kind of, things are kind of on hold artistically because, you know, everything's closed.
Many on this call can relate. Ryan, Mark, I want to thank you for joining us today, and I want to give everyone a preview of what we're going to be looking at next week. So next week we have something very special planned. We're going to be joined by the gallerist Jason Jacques, who specializes in turn of the century European porcelains, and he's going to be talking to us from his famous porcelain vault in his home where his deepest, darkest, amazing clay secrets are held. So we're going to be looking at Baroque and intemperate turn of the century porcelain objects next week and sharing some very drool-worthy images. This is the most recent publication that Jason put out that has 30 of his greatest top hits from his era as a gallerist. So if you want more spicy material, same time, same place next week. So the Everson will be open in just over 1 week, August 1st for members and August 2nd for the general public. No admission will be charged, and we of course will be requiring masks and adhering to social distancing rules. So come see us in person at the Everson next Friday. The food trucks will be back and we'll be happy to see people and show them art again. So thanks everybody. Feel free to unmute and join us for the after party. Thank you, Mark. Thank you, Ryan.
What up, play?